Pastor Valerie Holcomb would like to welcome all of our first-time visitors, returning visitors, and CHOP family and friends to the Christian House of Prayer Ministries. Thank you for joining us for our 10 a.m. service. We pray that you'll experience the light, life, and love of God during this morning service. Again, we say welcome and look forward to seeing you again next week right here at the Christian House of Prayer Ministries, where it's all about Him, Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. God is good. Let us go before the throne of grace as we bow our heads and close our eyes in reverence to our life-changing King. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we come to your throne of grace this morning with thanksgiving in our hearts and a praise on our lips, saying, blessed be the name of the Lord. Father, you are good. You are so good. What time of the day, Father, that you're not good? You're good in the morning. You're good in the noonday. You're good in the evening. You're good in the midnight hour. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. For you are good, Lord. Hallelujah. You're worthy to be praised. Father, we thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for our sins. And we thank you for not leaving us where you found us. Oh, Father, we are so grateful and thankful for you, Lord. And we thank you for our pastor. We thank you for Pastor Valerie Holcomb, a virtuous woman of God who makes herself of no reputation, that you, O Lord, be glorified. Father, we ask you, Father, continue to keep her in perfect peace as her mind is set and stayed on you. And as the body of Christ here at the Christian House of Prayer, we're going to give our pastor place and space, that she may continue to live a balanced life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. You are our Lord, our light, our love, our liberty, and you've given us a new labor. And we thank you for those that labor amongst us, and that of the elders, the staff, the deacons, the leadership, and the membership of the Christian House of Prayer. Father, we thank you that we're not stale, stagnant, or stuck, but we are renewed in our mind by the washing of your word, that we may continue to practice careful reverence. Oh, Father, we bless you, Lord. Homologeo, we speak the same thing, that we see people online waiting to hear a word of God that's going to change their life forever. Oh, Father, thank you, Father, for the axe head anointed power of God that's able to save souls this morning. Thank you, Father, drawing the backsliders onto yourself today and planting those in a house of God that they may flourish in the courts of our God in Jesus' name. Oh, Father, we bless you for that, Lord. And Father, right now we come against the mind blinder. He that put negative and non-productive thoughts in our mind. We bind you, Satan, in the name of Jesus Christ. You can't have our minds. You can't have our thoughts. You can't have our joy. You can't have our peace. You can't have our song. You can't have our dance. Hallelujah. We bless you this morning. Holy Spirit, we say have your way in this place. You are our up in a down world. You kept us all throughout this year. We made it, Father. We made it, and we're still standing. You have fully persuaded us. You persuaded us that everything is going our way in the Lord. And we stand today fully persuaded that what you have promised, you're well able to perform it. In Jesus' name, Father, we pray. And we say amen and amen. Hallelujah.
Come on and put those hands together. How many of you know that the presence of the Lord is in this place? And where the presence of the Lord is, there's fullness of joy. Hallelujah.
The presence of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. The presence of the Lord is here. The presence of the Lord.
we love your presence, oh God. We lift our hands and we say, God, fall on us. Kiss us with your glory.
Oh,
Please join me at this time as we declare the 91st Psalm. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wing shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him, and show him my salvation. The Christian House of Prayer invites you to come and worship with us every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. Come and enjoy the Word, the worship, and the presence of God as we adjust to our new normal. We've taken all precautions and we're following CDC guidelines to make your worship experience as safe as possible. Interested in worshiping with us? Log on to CHOP.org tomorrow morning beginning at 9 a.m. and click the Reservations tab to reserve your seat. Upon arrival of service, please wear your mask and be prepared to have your temperature checked and sanitization complete before entering the service. The Christian House of Prayer is doing the practical to keep all of our members as safe as possible. Come worship with us next Sunday at the Christian House of Prayer Ministries, where it's all about Him, Jesus Christ. Pastor Valerie Holcomb would like to wish the Christian House of Prayer family a very happy Thanksgiving. Just a friendly reminder, please remember to wear your mask during the entire service and practice social distancing during worship and as you move throughout the sanctuary. Thank you. The Christian House of Prayer has made giving easy, safe, and convenient. Log on to CHOP.org or the CHOP app to give from your electronic devices or give in person on Sundays from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. and on Wednesdays from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. in our Killeen location. You may also give during business hours from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. on Mondays, Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays in our Copper's Cove location. Give by mail at P.O. Box 960, Copper's Cove, Texas 76522. or at the Covenant Savings Federal Credit Union's Night Depository Box, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. God has been a faithful God and always will be. So let's continue to do the practical and watch Him do the providential in this season. The Christian House of Prayers Prison and Jail Ministry's annual Project Angel Tree program is just around the corner. Project Angel Tree provides gifts to children whose parents are incarcerated. If you are interested in being a blessing to a little boy or girl this holiday season, signups are currently in progress now until December 6th. If you're interested, please sign up at the counters in the foyer with the Prison and Jail Ministry before and after service. For the promises on which we've stood from a Savior who is good, we give thanks. For the comfort of our beds and the roof over our heads, we give thanks. To work, to be employed, for the provisions that we enjoy, we give thanks. For the love that we share and the support of those who care, we give thanks. And when we're at the end of our rope, for the assurance of faith and hope, we give thanks. In the pain of what we've lost, for the resurrection that follows a cross, we give thanks. For the miracles you've shown, because you forgot not your own, we give thanks. And as we are grateful for all that we've got, help us to remember all those who have not. The hungry, the jobless, the grieving, the homeless. Nurture our gratitude into compassion until our thanks transforms into action, that through our giving your kingdom may grow, that through our living your love would be known, so that many more people, both far and near, during this season and throughout the year, may give thanks.
Christian House of Prayer family, what a joy it is for us to be together in this time of worship and praise. As we move now into worshiping the Lord in the giving of our tithes and offerings, the Bible reminds us in Proverbs 23:7 that as a man or woman thinks, that is who we really are. Being created in the image and likeness of God, we are the only aspect of creation that has the ability of imagination. We have been taught in this ministry that if you can conceive it, believe it, you shall receive it. The word conceive simply means to imagine or the mind. So if we can conceive it in our minds, believe it by faith, we're going to receive it in our bank accounts. That's a good place for somebody to say amen. This three-step process is proven for the believing believer in obedience to the giving of the tithe and a free will offering, and how we think about what we give to God. How we think about our giving to God is an expression of our love for God. We love you, Lord, and we do what we do because of our love for you. When you and I think about all that God has given to us, oh, the breath that we just breathe, the roof over our head, the shoes on our feet, the older saints used to say, and kept us in our right minds. And so when we think about all that God has given to us, even the money that we have in our bank accounts now, the little or beyond all that we once had, He's given us more, because He is the abundant God that gives us all that He desires. So when we again understand that we are the only creatures on the planet that have the power of imagination, and yet many cannot conceive or imagine themselves to being blessed to the point of being debt-free and broke no more. In your house, in your car, on your job this week, just practice. Conceive it in your mind. Believe it by faith and receive the fact that I'm blessed, I'm debt free, and I won't be broke no more. I'm blessed, I'm debt free, and I won't be broke no more. One more time. I'm blessed, I'm debt free, and I won't be broke no more. How does this reality come to pass? By us conceiving it, by believing it in faith and receiving it by our confidence in God. This reality, we must confess it until it manifests. And as we are moving out of the year 2020 and into the year 2021, confess, I'm blessed, I'm debt free, and I won't be broke no more. The way of the reality, of this reality coming to pass in our lives, is the three-step process. Conceive it in your mind, believe it by faith, and receive it in every facet of your life. Because as we give to God, it shows him how much we love him and declares to him or our desire to please him by obedience to his word. When we give to God from our hearts, he gives to us what's in his hands, and that is a prosperous life. Conceive it, believe it, and receive it. Join me now as we pray. Father, we bless you and thank you for this opportunity to obey your word in the giving of our tithe and our offering. Father, we do conceive it, we do believe it, and we shall receive it because of our faith in you. And so, Father, we want you to know that our love for you is a sign and a symbol in this tithe and in this offering that we give this morning. And so, Father, we give it in the spirit of love, gratitude, and appreciation. So, Father, as we give it from our hearts, we know you're going to give to us what's in your hands, and that is a prosperous life. This is our prayer and declaration in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Please stand with me now and follow the directions of the deacons as we pass the dollar in support of our Refuge Corporation and we receive our tithe and our offering.
People are standing in line to get into this church to hear the word of God. Every seat is filled in every service with expectations of signs, wonders, and miracles. Our Sunday morning service at 10 o'clock in Killeen, our Wednesday night service at 7 o'clock in Killeen, and any other service that we might have. Every need in this ministry is met, and we are 100% tithe givers. All of our property is paid off in full, and we owe nothing to no man but to love. Every member of this church is healed, healthy, blessed, and prosperous, and we are reaching the world with the gospel through our prayers and support. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been open. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been open. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. And being fully persuaded that what he hath promised, he was able also to perform. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Come on, put your hands together, family. Come on, put your hands together. Come on, let's let him know that he's still welcome in this place. Come on, taste and see that the Lord is good. Come on now, David said, I had fainted unless I had believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Even in this time of COVID, we can see the goodness of the Lord. If you believe it, give him some praise. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. My. You may take your seat in his presence. Praise God. Amen. We do honor the Spirit of Christ. Amen. On this morning, to our pastor, Pastor Valerie Holcomb. Hallelujah. Come on. Amen. Thank you for gracing me with this opportunity. Amen. To once again stand behind this sacred desk in this hallowed spot to our elders in this great house, to the deacons, to the Christian House of Prayer family, to UCCI. Amen. And to my wife for life, the queen of my dreams for 33 years. Amen. She's my reason for favor. Amen. For my three children that she gave me, bore me, I thank them. Amen. And I want to say to you all, grace to all and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. May God bless you with his peace, love, and blessings. And may they be multiplied. Amen. Amen. We're going to get right to the word. Amen. The gospel according to Matthew. This is a very familiar passage of scripture, the 16th chapter. For some of you, amen, it'll be new. To others, it'll be review. But to all of us, it'll be true. Amen. We know that it takes faith and nothing else will do. Hallelujah. Matthew's the 16th chapter. Amen. I'm going to start my reading at verse 13. If you're there, say amen. Amen. And there you find these words. And Jesus came unto the coast of Caesarea Philippi. He asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? They said, some say that thou art John the Baptist. Some say Elias. Others Jeremiah and one of the prophets. He said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, behold, thou art Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood had not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. May God ever add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his most holy word. Amen. You may take your seats. He goes on to say, and I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'm going to build my church. Say build. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Amen. I would like to use for a brief thought this morning. The church has the axe head anointing. For a subtopic, stick with the church. Amen. If the church has the axe head anointing, family, we need to stick with the church. Amen. For the past several weeks, our pastor has been teaching from 2 Kings, the 6th chapter, verse 1 through 7. And her title is, we need the axe head anointing. Now, just in case there are some that doubt or have reservations about the relevancy of the Old Testament scripture, let me remind you what the Apostle Paul tells young Timothy in 2 Timothy 3 and 16. He said, all scripture, that means the entire Bible, is given from inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, and for instructions, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished, that word means complete, unto all good works. He tells the church at Corinth, now all these things happen unto them for ensamples. And they are written for our admonition. Amen. In the NIV, that means were written down as a warning for us. Amen. So we see that there's relevance to the Old Testament scripture. All scripture, not some of it, all of it. The Old Testament and the New Testament is profitable unto us. God told Ezekiel, I need you to eat the whole roll. Don't eat part of it. After you eat it, then you can go and speak to the house. But you got to eat the whole roll, amen? So we find, praise God, and I just want to recap just a few things on what our pastor has been teaching on, this axe head anointing, so that I can lay a foundation for where we're going. Amen. If we look in 2 Kings, the 6th chapter, we find that the sons of the prophets convinced prophet Elijah that the building they currently occupied was too small. So they moved, and while they were moving, they began to work on their building. The Bible says that they move and they begin to cut and they begin to work because they were building on their building, so they were cutting and they were working, and the tool of choice was an axe. That's what they had. And they worked, I said, and they cut. And as I begin to meditate on that, I say, God, what are you saying to us? God said, all of us have a building, and we got to work, and we got to cut. We got to work on our buildings, and we got to cut, but we got to use the proper tools. Amen. We got to use the axe head, the axe itself, in order to cut and work on our building. So while they was working and they were cutting, they were working on their building. Now remember, Jesus just said that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'ma build my church. Amen. Jesus said that he was gonna build his church, and he had to use a tool in order to build the church. Amen. That's the reason he told his disciples to go into Jerusalem and wait until you're endowed with power from on high. Because he recognized that it was going to take, amen, something special in order for them to build. I say, I'm working and I'm building on my building. Now, I don't know about your building, but my building get tired sometime. But I still got to work and I got a cut on my building. Look at your neighbor and say, are you working? Are you cutting on your building? Now, Pastor told us that you got to use the cutting edge in order to work on your building. Amen. Sometimes my building, as the songwriter was said, it keeps on leaning. So I got to work on it, and I got to cut on it. Amen. Sometimes my building has a leak in it. There's a leak in this old building, and my soul has got to move. But I'm still working on my building, and I got to use the cutting edge. See, you can't use the axe handle to work on your building. The axe handle won't do any good. Amen. You need the axe head. David said, unless the Lord builds the house, it buildeth labor in vain. So you're laboring in vain if you're trying to use the handle and not the cutting edge. You got to use the axe head anointing to work on your building. So what is the axe head anointing? Well, our pastor said this. The axe head represents the power of God, the Holy Ghost, released in our lives to do God's work. Not in our own strength, not in our own might, but in the Holy Ghost. God told Zerubbabel that it's not by power, that is not by might, but it's by my spirit, said the Lord God of hosts. So while the prophets of Elijah was working and they were cutting, the Bible says that the axe head dislodged itself from the handle and was lost in the water. See, you can't work without the axe head. So everything comes to a screeching halt when you don't use the cutting edge. Everything stops when you don't use the cutting edge. See, you can't work on your building if you're not using the... Oh, y'all getting it now. Y'all getting it. See, you got to use the... in order to work on your building. But they lost the axe head in the water. And so they goes to the man of God and they said, we've lost that which was borrowed. Elijah says, show me where you lost it. Sometimes we got to go back to where we lost it. Oh, come on, somebody. Maybe I'm the only one that lost it. Maybe you never lost your axe head anointing. But see, I lost my axe head anointing before because my building kept on. Oh, y'all gonna get it. Y'all getting it. Y'all getting it. So the prophet says, show me where you lost it. So he takes a stick and he places it in the water. And the Bible says that the iron did swim. So what we saw was the supernatural in the natural. It was natural for them to lose the axe head, the iron. But it was supernatural for that iron to swim back up and connect itself to the stick. If you believe it, say amen. Amen. So Elijah said, pick it up. Go ahead and pick up the axe head and continue to work, praise God. Amen. We got to know and use the axe head to work on our building, praise God. That's what it's going to take. We got to learn how to experience the supernatural in the natural. See, we try to do a lot of things with just a stick. And that's what happens when you just use the stick. You never experience the supernatural. You never see the supernatural move of God. Because there's nothing in the stick. The stick is you trying to do something that only God can do. So you got to use the axe head or nothing. You got to know and see the experience, the supernatural in the natural. See, we can depend on the supernatural power of God to do. It will produce results. It'll produce results in your work. It'll produce results in your finances. That axe head anointing will produce results in your marriage, in your home. And let me say this, in your children. That prodigal son or that prodigal daughter, don't you give up on them. That's God's seed. You stick with your prodigal sons and daughter and you use the axe head anointing. It works. How many of you know that it works? Hallelujah. It works. We got to exercise our faith, praise God. Amen. The axe head anointing is available to you. Amen. The church has the axe head anointing. And all you got to do is use it. Use your faith. Say something. Give something. Amen. Release your faith, praise God. Use what's available with the axe head anointing. The Apostle Paul recognized that he needed the axe head anointing. Amen. When you look in 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. Go ahead and turn there. You'll find in verse 7. The Apostle Paul says this. Unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me. He was being tormented. He was being buffeted, praise God, by Satan. Lest I should be exalted above measure. Amen. Verse 8 says, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart me. Paul said, I didn't go to the Lord one time. I didn't go to the Lord two times. But I went to the Lord three times for him to move this thorn in my flesh that was buffeting me. Amen. And this is what the Lord said to him in verse 9. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, would I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power, the axe head anointing. Paul realized that he needed the axe head anointing in order to make it in his journey. He said that the power of God would rest upon me. Listen, I know sometimes the cares of this world, the weight of this world is heavy on your shoulders, praise God. And you go to God and he won't release them. But what God will do, he'll strengthen your shoulders so that you can carry the load, praise God. Paul could carry the load now, praise God, because he tapped into the axe head anointing. And that's what we got to do, family. We got to tap into the axe head anointing. It works. I said it's available to you, praise God. The church has the axe head anointing. Now let's look at this. If you want to use the axe head anointing, the question rings out, what will it cost me? Oh, you didn't think it was free. I mean, y'all thought it was free? Oh, the axe head anointing is going to cost you something. Well, what will it cost me there, bro, Prater? It's going to cost you everything. Look at your neighbor and say, everything. Jesus said, if any man will come after me, amen, that means be my disciple, he must deny self. In other words, forget about himself, lose sight of himself, lose sight of his interest, take up his cross. How often should he take it up? Only when I'm in trouble. Only when I have a need. Only when I'm fearful. He said, take it up daily and follow me and follow him. I'm not talking about the H-Y-M-E in him. I'm not talking about the H-E-M him. But the him I'm talking about is Jesus, praise God. He's still the base, the bound, the balance, the beauty, the center and circumference, the sum and the substance of what our lives are all about. It's all about him. It's all about him. It's all about him. Still about Jesus. But I got to share something with your family. Before we can access this axe head anointing, glory, thank you, Jesus. God says it's available to you. And he wants you to have the axe head anointing. But before you can access the axe head anointing, you got to know who Jesus is. It's still all about him. It's all about Jesus. I mean, he is the reason, praise God. He's the one that died for us, praise God. So you got to know who Jesus is. And that brings me into my text. Hallelujah. Now listen, God woke me up at like 2:30 this morning and I was saying, Lord, wait a minute. I already got 30 pages. I mean, you still trying? No, I'm just joking. I'm just joking. Amen. I promise you, I'll get you out of here before Popeye's, I mean, Cracker Barrel close. Amen. But God woke me up. Amen. And I began to continue to write. So in our text, Jesus takes his disciples to Caesarea Philippi. And I was wondering, I was saying, Lord, why did you leave an area that was well known to them and take them to Caesarea Philippi? So I tried to exegete that scripture. And man, I said, the only thing I found was that I realized that the Caesarea Philippi was a city. It was the mega of idol worship. They had everything going on in that city imaginable. They had all kind of temples built for idol gods. And it was with this backdrop that Jesus wanted to ask his disciples some important questions. So he takes them to Caesarea Philippi, and he asks his disciples. See, Caesarea Philippi is much like the world we live in. Huh? Amen. If you go outside these doors, you run into all kind of gods. Huh? You run into all kind of trouble, all kind of sin. And that's what Caesarea Philippi represents. It represents the world. Praise God. And Jesus asked his disciples, whom do men, I'm talking about these men in the world, say that I, the Son of Man, am? I told you got to know who Jesus is. I'm not saying know about him. I say you got to know him. That implies intimacy. Amen. You got to have a relationship with him. Praise God. So he asked them, whom do men, family, the same question applies to us. Who do you say that Jesus is? Who is he to you, praise God? What is he to you? What has he done? Do you know what he's done? So he asked his disciples, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they begin to answer. They say, some say that you're John the Baptist. Well, we all know who John the Baptist is, praise God. Amen. John the Baptist was that voice crying in the wilderness, saying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make his path straight, praise God. Amen. John, we know, was a stylish dresser. Amen. He walked around in camel's hair and had a leather girt about his loins. John didn't eat the regular steak and potatoes that we eat. His favorite food was locusts and wild honey. Amen. That's why I always say you can't recognize a person by what they wear. Amen. Don't you look at the suit, you look at the fruit. Amen. For the tree is known by the fruit it bears. Amen. The devil walks around in sheep clothing. He presents himself as an angel of light. Amen. So you got to inspect their fruit, praise God. John said, amen, it's one that's coming after me that's mightier than I, whose shoelaces I'm not worthy to unlatch. Say, I indeed baptize you unto water with repentance, but he's going to baptize you with Holy Ghost, the axe head anointing, and with fire. But he wasn't John the Baptist. So he said, well, maybe you're Elias. You're that guy that called down fire from heaven. Amen. The miracle working prophet, they call him. Amen. Who had a message of repentance, but he wasn't Elijah. Some say, Jesus, that you're Jeremiah. You're the weeping prophet. Had a message of doom because Israel turned their back on God and began to worship the idol Baal, the weeping prophet, but he wasn't Jeremiah's. Some say that you're one of the prophets, or you're just a great messenger, although all of these men would have been great company to be in, Jesus was more than they. He was more than they because he was more than just a great messenger. He was the message. He was more than one that just brought the word. He was the word. And John clears it up for us because John says, in the beginning was the word. And the word was with God, and the word was God, and the same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him. And without him, there was not anything made that was made. And then John throws us a fast pitch. If you skip on down to verse 14, he said, and the word was made flesh, dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory as that of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. I'm glad that the word was made flesh, praise God. Amen. Man couldn't go to God, so God came down to man. Man couldn't go to heaven, so heaven came down to man, praise God. Amen. I'm glad that the word was made flesh, because the word was made flesh, Jesus knows what it's like to cry. He knows what it's like to suffer loss. He knows what it's like to be lied on, to be betrayed by his brethren, to be talked about by his countrymen. Jesus knows what it's like, praise God. The Bible says that we have not a high priest that can't be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points. I say all points, praise God. And no matter what you're going through or what you've been through, I say all points. Tempted like as we were. Your situation, all points, praise God. Your condition, amen, your position, your circumstances, the problems, amen, that seem too hard for you, all points. But yet without sin, Jesus knows what it's like, praise God. All you got to do, though, is release your faith. Release your faith and use the axe head anointing. Jesus was obedient, even unto death. Even unto death, praise God, and the world still didn't know him. The Bible says that he was despised and rejected of men. A man of sorrow, acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he had bore our griefs. Did he not bear our griefs? He carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquity, and the chastisement of our peace was upon him. With his stripes, we are all healed. They hung him high. They stretched him wide. He hung his head for you and me. He died. He could have come down off that cross. He could have come down, but Hernando kept him up there. Elder Solomon kept him up there. Amen. Eunice, you kept him up there. We kept him chopped on the cross. All of us, praise God. He could have come down. But he didn't, because of his great love for us. Greater love had no man than this, that a man would lay down his life for his friends. The Bible said that God so loved, best lover, that he gave his only best giver, begotten son, the best gift. Amen, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life, best return, praise God. That's what God did for us. Amen. He gave us his best. Jesus was God incarnate, the word of God personified. Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah. It's all about him, praise God. See, the real question that is faced before all of us who will hear the message of Jesus is, do you know who Jesus is? Well, what does the Bible say about who Jesus is? Well, the Bible says he's Elohim, the God with us. It says he's El Shaddai. He's the Almighty God. He's El Elyon. He's the Most High God. He's Jehovah Sikkenu. He's our righteousness. He's Jehovah Shalom. He's the God of peace. He's the definite article. That means he's unique. That means he's one of a kind. That means he's all by himself and that there's none like him. None like him. King Solomon said he's the bright and morning star. He's the sweet rose of Sharon. He's the lily of the valley. Who is he to you? We got to know who Jesus is. Who is Jesus to you, family? Do you know what he's done? Who do you say that he is? Family, it is we that's going to be judged by our answer. Amen. You're going to be judged by your answer. If you really know who Jesus is, Jesus said that it'll show up in the way you walk. It'll show up in the way you talk. It'll show up in the way you live. It'll show up in the way you give. If you really know who Jesus is, it'll show up in you. The world will see something different about you, praise God. Amen. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Amen. We're a city that's set upon a hill that cannot be hid. We're the salt of the earth, praise God. If you know who Jesus is, it's going to show up in you. When I was in Europe, we used to sing a song. The song was, "I'm so glad that I know who Jesus is." And it says, everybody don't know who Jesus is. It's all about him. Amen. Jesus said, "Peter, flesh and blood had not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." Amen. Jesus revealed to Peter that he spoke by divine inspiration. He had the revelation of a difference. Peter had faith to believe. Amen. The Bible in Romans 10 and 17 says, "Faith, so then faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." He said, "Thou art Peter, Petros." We know we've been taught that. You're a small rock. Huh? You're a rock that can be tossed or thrown. He said, "But on this rock, Petros, the giant rock, the massive rock," Bishop used to say, "a rock that cannot be thrown, I'm going to build my church. And the gates of hell should not prevail against it." Church is ecclesia. That means the called out ones. That means you, family. You're the called out ones that God is going to build his church with. And it's going to take the axe head anointing. It's going to take the axe head anointing, praise God. He said, "Upon this rock," the rock is Jesus Christ, "I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell should not prevail against it." Isn't that a precious, a treasured promise to us? Amen. Isn't it precious to us? You see, the devil is upset. Hey, everything that he's tried to do to stop the advancement of the church has failed. Amen. Everything. So he's now using the government to try to keep the doors of some churches closed. But the Bible tells us that he won't prevail. Amen. Amen. Go ahead. Don't panicate. Hallelujah. You know, we know that this is nothing to do with Democrats or Republicans, but it's an attack on the body of Christ. That's what it's really about, praise God. Amen. Listen, after over 2,000 years, the church still stands. That's why I'm sticking with the church. Amen. You can call me what you want to call me, but I'm sticking with the church. Huh? You can drag me through the mud, but I'm sticking with the church. Because the church ain't going nowhere. The church got history. So I'm sticking with this church, praise God. We got to stick with the church. All the power and policies of hell combined couldn't defeat the church. Look, all the pharaohs, all the Ahabs, all the Jezebels, all the King Herods, all the Neros, they couldn't stop the advancement of the church. Amen. The church was driven into the wilderness, driven in dens, driven underground, praise God. Amen. Driven in caves, driven in different parts of the world, praise God. But the church still stands. The church live on. Why wouldn't you want to serve a God like this? It's the only entity, it's the only organism that got longevity. Amen. Kingdoms have fallen. Nations have fallen. Queens have fallen. But the church lives on. I'm sticking with the church, praise God. I'm sticking with the church. The church ain't going nowhere, praise God. You better stick with the church, family. You better stick with the church, CCI. The church is here to stay, praise God. They can't stop it. The devil is still trying. He's still trying, praise God, to do what he can to slow down the church. The church that I'm talking about, it don't need ceremonies. It don't need cathedrals. Oh, somebody's going to get excited. It don't need buildings. It don't need chapels, praise God. It don't need organs. It don't need kings. It don't need governments. It don't need magistrates, praise God. It don't need favor from man. Why? Because the gates of hell can't prevail against it, because we got the axe head anointing. We got the yoke destroy and burden lifting power of the Holy Ghost, and it can't be stopped. The church is here to stay. I'm sticking with the church, family. The church is gonna last. My mind is made up. Is your mind made up? My heart is fixed. I'm sticking with the church. I hear the clarion call. I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. I'm sticking with the church. And just in case you didn't know who the church is, let me make it plain to you. The church is all who believe in Jesus Christ, all born of the Spirit, all possess repentance towards God. Holiness is their way of life. They hate sin, pray without ceasing, believe in believers, Spirit-filled, led by the Spirit, speak the same thing, have the same mind, the same judgment, same love, same undercare, same spirit, same rule, same diligence. I'm sticking with the church. I'm sticking with the church. Ah, glory to God. Peter says it like this, that we're a chosen generation. Family, you're chosen. You're a royal priesthood. You're peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who brought you out of darkness into his marvelous light. We different than the world. Don't let nobody tell you you're the same. Amen. You're chosen by God. You handpicked. You're special to him. He holds you in the palm of his hand. I'm sticking with the church. The church has the axe head anointing. It's available to you, praise God. The church is the body of Christ. It's the household of faith. It's the family of God. The church is a living organism that Jesus has left here on earth to carry out and carry on the mission of evangelizing the world. That's our mission. That's our job, praise God, to evangelize this world. The church has the axe head anointing. As I'm about to close, I'm not going to be before you long, I told you. There are three reasons that I want to give you that you can put in your toolkit for sticking with the church. The first reason is the church has the axe head anointing. Acts 1:8 says, but ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses. Now, witnesses is a Greek word, meritus, M-A-R-T-I-T-U-S. It means to die for. It's where we get our English word, martyr. The disciples knew that being a witness would cost them their lives, but they went anyhow. They went anyway. Amen. Just like Job had faith in God, though he slay me, I'm going anyway, yet will I trust him. I'm going to maintain my ways before the Lord. Just like Esther, she said, if I die, let me die, but I'm going to see the king. She had faith unmovable, operated in the axe head anointing. You're going to need it. You're going to need it. You're going to need the axe head anointing. Hallelujah. The church has the axe head anointing. He said, you're going to be witnesses. He said, unto me. And remember, that might cost you something. But he said, in Jerusalem. Jerusalem is your own home. Huh? He said in Judea. Judea is your own neighborhood. It's your own city. He said in Samaria. That's those people you don't like. Come on now. That's the ones you don't socialize with. Huh? That's your Samaria. You know those houses you dare not go? Jesus said, I need you to be a witness unto me, to them, and to the uttermost parts of the world, wherever you might go. Don't think just because you're on a cruise, you're not one of mine. Oh, I'm going to meddling now. Just because you travel to New York, don't think that you're one of his. He still can use you because we're bought with a price. We're not our own. I'm still talking about his power. The church has the axe head anointing. That was reason one. Reason two is the church has the plans. What plan is that? The plan of salvation. You have the words of eternal life. Huh? Romans 10 and 9 says that if I confess that, amen, it doesn't say that. It says, if thou confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thy heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, thou shalt be saved. The plan of salvation, he didn't give it to the big government. He didn't give it to pharmaceuticals. Huh? He didn't give it to the White House. He gave it to us. Amen. You're the church. You're the church. You're the church. We are the church. And we have the axe head anointing, praise God. That was two. The next one is the church has the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ, as his head shepherd. Psalms 118 and 22 says, the stone which the builders refuse is become the headstone of the corner. Philippians 2, 9 and 11 say, wherefore God had highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, of things in heaven, of things in the earth, and of things under the earth. And every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Hebrews 12 and 2 said, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the glory of God was set before him, endured the Christ at the cross, despising the shame, and he's now sit down at the right hand throne of God. I say now he's sitting down at the right hand of power with God. You see, right now there's only two seats in heaven. There's a seat for God the Father, and there's a seat for God the Son. Yes, we do know that there is a Holy Ghost, but the Holy Ghost is not sitting down. And the reason God the Father is sitting down, he created the world in 6 days and he rested on the seventh. He has a right to sit down. The reason God the Son is sitting down, he hung on a cross from the sixth to the ninth hour and he said it is finished. He has a right to sit down, but the Holy Ghost don't have a seat in heaven. His seat is in the church. His seat is in my heart. His seat is in my mind. I'm sticking with the church. I'm sticking with the church. I'll let nothing separate me from his love. Neither death nor life, angels nor principalities nor powers gonna separate me from his love. Neither things coming are things going, but I'm going to stick with the church because the church has the axe head anointing. Come on, give him a praise. Come on, give him a praise. We got to stick, family, with the church. The church has the axe head anointing. The church has the power. You can make it with the axe head anointing. You can take it with the axe head anointing. Use your power. Use your power. It's supernatural power. It's yours. It's available to you. is yours for the asking. Come on, put your hands together. I'm almost finished. Hallelujah. The church has the axe head anointed. I'm sticking with the church. Amen. I've been on this way, this journey for a while. And the church is still here. Family, I want to admonish you. You that are out there in TV land. Man, get into the church. Get back to the household of faith. This is where it's at. I understand, like the pastor said, if you have underlying issues, you got to take care of yourself. But if you're sitting at home and you're doing well, you're going to Burger King, you're going to Cracker Barrel. I mean, if you're not, you're all right. But I'm saying you need to get back into the household of faith. Because the church is going to last. Ah, Shabbatsa. Woo, glory. The church is here to stay. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you now for what our ears have heard. Father God, we ask that you would write your word upon the fleshly tables of our heart, that we won't sin against you. Father God, you're the one, as the song says, will never leave the one behind. You're quick to leave the 99 and go find that one. Father God, it is for this reason that we have hope, because your compassion fails not, but they're new every morning. And we thank you, Father. Hallelujah. There may be one in here that don't know Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. Amen. You have left the King's Highway because you begin to look off to your left or to your right, and you begin to look at the lilies of the field. And you left and you went and you begin to pick the lilies. Jesus is saying, I want you. I need you. You don't know him as your personal Lord and Savior. That might be one that says, after hearing the message, the church has the axe head anointing. I want to make Jesus my home. If this is you, acknowledge by just raising your hand. I'm going to make three appeals. Is there one that says, yes, I want to welcome Jesus into my life? Is there one? Is there one? Amen. You that are out there watching by telecast, amen, just wherever you are, extend your hand up in the air. Hallelujah. Is there one? Hallelujah. You used to be on fire for the Lord, my next appeal. But for some reason, things are not like they used to be. Amen. You don't feel that fire that you used to feel. Amen. You don't read your Bible and study your word and have fellowship with God like you used to. Want you to know that he's married to the backslider. Maybe you want to rededicate your life back to the Lord. If this is you, acknowledge just by raising your hand. Say yes. Amen. I've left the beaten path. I've left the King Highway, but I want to get back on it. If this is you, acknowledge by raising your hand. Hallelujah. Maybe you're here in this area and you don't have a church home. Glory to God. And we're not going to ask you to move your church letter, but a tree can't grow unless it's planted. And you need to be planted somewhere so that you can hear the unadulterated word of God. Our pastor, Pastor Valerie Holcomb, would love to have you here so that you can grow and be taught. If this is you, raise your hand and say, yes, I want to make Christian House of Prayer, my home. If this is you, raise your hand. That might be one. Amen. I see the one. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Is there another? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. We're going to give you a few more minutes. If you want to acknowledge either one of those appeals, salvation, rededication, a church membership, I'm going to ask that you would pick up your belongings and come to the center aisle. Come on down, and we promise we're not going to do anything to embarrass you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, family. We got a new member. Hallelujah. Hey, give God praise. Give God praise. God bless you, sister. God bless you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. And just in case there's someone out there in TV land, amen. Amen. There's another one. Come on. Amen. Give him praise. Give him praise. Hallelujah. It's all right. This is what it's about. It's all about him. Amen. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and repeat these words after me. Dear God in heaven, I come to you in Jesus' name. Forgive me, Lord, of every sin that I've committed unto you. Father, with my mouth, I confess Jesus Christ as my Lord, as my Savior, as head of my life. And with my heart, I believe you, God, raised Jesus from the dead. And he is alive right now and forevermore. Father, according to your word, I am saved. Amen. If you prayed that prayer out there, amen, there's going to be a number at the bottom of our screen at the conclusion of our service. Amen. We want you to pick up a phone and dial that number, and there'll be someone on the other end, amen, that's going to talk to you, amen, about the confession you just made. Amen. We want to thank and praise God for you that have come down. Praise God. Amen. Amen. There's going to be someone that's going to take you to the side to make sure that your need is met. Amen. And if all hearts and minds are clear, amen, let us bow our heads for the benediction. May the Lord watch between me and thee while we're absent from one another. Hence, now, and forevermore, Father, we thank you. Go in peace and love and blessings. In Jesus' name, amen. You're dismissed.